What happens when a filmmaker purposely goes against the genre that their film belongs to? What happens when genre is subverted? In this first episode, we will look at subversion of the Western genre, which is perhaps one of the most recognizable genres in film. The basic groundwork for a traditional Western consists of a cowboy, sheriff, or another gunslinging hero that protects the frontier from evildoers. But maybe more significantly, Westerns were supposed to embody American ideals. Throughout the 60s and 70s, revisionist Westerns began to emerge. Also referred to as anti-Westerns, these films used the genre to criticize the traditional American values so heavily associated with classical Westerns. Revisionist Westerns are still very common today, always turning the connotations of the genre against us. While many films effectively subvert the genre, I want to specifically look at three films that I feel do it best. These films are Clint Eastwood's Unforgiven, the Coen Brothers' No Country for Old Men, and Ang Lee's Brokeback Mountain. Let's take a look at how these films open. This is the opening shot of Unforgiven, and these are the opening shots of No Country for Old Men. They showcase a sunset and a sunrise, respectively. Why is this significant? Well, I'm sure we are all familiar with the trope of the cowboy riding off into the sunset at the end of a traditional Western. The fact that these films open with a setting sun and a rising sun seems to suggest that this traditional period is over. This is a new Western, a different frontier. Brokeback Mountain opens with Cowboy Ennis Delmar, played by Heath Ledger, hitchhiking his way to a job interview. This is a far cry from the way the traditional cowboy shows up. Look at how John Wayne's character is introduced in Stagecoach.
Hold it!
It's grand and triumphant, and most importantly, it's heroic. Ennis, on the other hand, is quite the opposite. He seems lost and helpless. Speaking of which, take a look at how Bill Money, played by Clint Eastwood, is introduced in Unforgiven. He's struggling to wrangle up his pigs, covered in their filth. He seems desperate and incompetent. This is even echoed in the first line that is spoken to him.
You don't look like no rootin' tootin' son of a bitch and cold-blooded assassin.
Even Sheriff Bell's formal introduction is rather revisionist. After he borrows his wife's horse, they have this exchange.
Be careful.
Always am.
Don't get hurt.
Never do.
Don't hurt no one.
If you say so.
In addition to suggesting that Bell is past his prime, this dialogue seems to be a critique of traditional Western values. The classic cowboy hero may be portrayed with the best of intentions, but he surely leaves a lot of bodies in his path. In Brokeback Mountain, there are no shootouts. The film subverts the Western by using it as a vehicle for a gay love story. Jack and Ennis are in love, but their world, and more importantly, the Western genre, doesn't allow for same-sex relationships. This is brilliantly showcased within the mise-en-scene. Lee uses the environment to minimize the cowboys rather than enhance them. Take The Searchers, for instance. Despite having revisionist themes, The Searchers is a prime example of classic Western styling. John Wayne doesn't succumb to his environment. The environment succumbs to him. On the contrary, the characters in Brokeback Mountain are never truly able to conquer their surroundings. The genre won't allow them to. All three of these films feature characters that support classic Western iconography. The hat, the boots, the horse, and so on. But they are simply shades of the traditional cowboy. Bill Money can't fire an accurate shot and can barely mount his horse. Sheriff Bell is timid and wary. And Ennis and Jack simply aren't allowed to be what they want to be. An interesting parallel is that in the beginning of the film, Ennis is the stronger, more prototypical cowboy character. However, as the film progresses, he grows weaker as Jack grows stronger. This is reflected in their costuming. Ennis starts off looking like a character out of a John Ford film, but slowly loses his iconic look. Jack, on the other hand, starts the film looking like an imitation of a cowboy and ends the film looking like a Western icon. In going against the grain of the genre and trying to embody this classic Western hero, Jack is punished. He isn't allowed to survive the film. Traditional Westerns usually end with some sort of glamorized shootout before the hero can ride off victorious into the sunset. But of course, this isn't the case with revisionist Westerns. In Unforgiven, we certainly get a shootout, but it's far from glamorous. Bill Money doesn't appear heroic. He appears sinister and evil. He isn't saving the day. He's seeking revenge. After shooting all the men, Money puts his gun to the throat of the sheriff, who would likely be the hero in a classic Western. The sheriff states,
"I don't deserve this."
To which Money replies,
"Deserves got nothing to do with it."
Again, this seems to be commenting on the supposedly justified killings in traditional westerns. In No Country for Old Men, we are prepared for a shootout that never happens. Sheriff Bell approaches the motel door and draws his weapon, which is an extreme rarity throughout the film. He seems to have finally worked up the courage necessary to not only solve this threat, but to reclaim his role within the Western. As he pushes the door open, we are presented with a very significant shot, his shadow on the wall, that of the iconic and heroic cowboy. But it's merely a shadow, all that's left of the hero. There is no showdown, there is no resolution. Sheriff Bell simply retires. He realizes that this is indeed no country for old men. He can no longer support the expectations of the genre he occupies. Much like our own world, no longer supports the ideals of the traditional Western.
You'd have to say, okay. I'll be part of this world.